understand their discernment to where they're using these tools, and it's by going through grade and grade and grade that they are able to elevate and then go into the promise, to where when God brings you the briefcase and it's time to go to work, those things that were in the book bag are now on you and in you, and if you spend enough time with your book bag, when he brings the briefcase, you'll be ready to go to work.
Yeah.
So I come to speak to somebody about carrying the book bag and understand that you have a specific book bag, and you have to carry your own bag, and you have to carry your own cross, and we can't get caught up worrying about everybody else's cross, because God has given us a book bag that has some specific things in it for your journey to get you to where he has you going. And see, if we get caught up in somebody else's book bag, we may end up within the wrong tools or within the wrong ideas, but God has a specific place for you to go, and it's within that book bag is those tools that he's going to bring out and reveal to you. And the more time you spend with the tools and with the Bible, and you spend so much time with it to where the stories start to come off the page, and you don't need the book to speak, because as I started speaking and I started to get into the Word, I got so much into the Word that I didn't even need the Word to speak. I didn't need the book in order to speak, because as I spent more and more time with God's Word, the Word became me, and I became one with God, and I was able to show the fruit of the labor. And if you can understand, if you get your spirit to come become one with God's spirit, and you can see fruit, people should see a reaction and a reflection of you becoming one with God and going through some things and letting God prune you and cut you back from some things, to where we understand Gideon, God had to prune some things and move some things around. He was the person that he was praying for, and sometimes God has us in a position to where we have to understand how to sift ourselves to find out what it is that God has. And God has Gideon they're threshing the wheat, and he's trying to figure out, God, send us somebody, but he didn't understand he was the person that he was praying for. And sometimes we get so caught up in the storm that we forget that God has helped you to understand something in a way that only you can solve the problem. But sometimes we forget that the problem is what makes us important. And without that problem, you're not important. So we have to understand how to embrace our book bag and our problem. But before I get too far into the message, I want to bring out a scripture. And I want to give you some scriptures to tie into today's message. But today's message is about carrying the book bag and embracing the process and understanding how to use our faith, and that understanding that without our faith, it's impossible to please God. And so when we understand that we have to have faith, and we have to stand on this word, and we have to be willing to go through some things to where then God can show us perfect, to where he can prune us and cut some things back, to where we understand that the people, when they went with Joshua, God told Joshua to circumcise them, because we were dealing with the people that hadn't been circumcised. And then when we look at this generation now, it seems like we're dealing with a generation of children and a generation of people that haven't been cut, and they haven't been circumcised and cut away from things that they need to get rid of so that God can take them to the next level. And tonight's message, today's message, the scripture I want to come from is right at Genesis 39:5, and he reads, and it says, and it came to pass, it says, from that time that he made him overseer in the house, and over all that he had, it says, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house, it says, for Joseph's sake. And so we understand that this house was blessed because Joseph was in it. It wasn't because of the Egyptians, it was because Joseph was there. And Joseph had went through many of different things to end up in this place, but wherever he went, it was showing us that God was there. And that's how we are. Wherever we go, God will be with us. But it says, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and all that he had in the field. And it's showing us that the things that Joseph touched and he set out to do were fruitful. And God was with him, and God assured that he was able to make these things happen. But there's a couple of scriptures I want to touch on and leave with you before we get too far into the message. And the first scripture I want to go to is Job 23:8. And Job 23:8, if you're following along, it says, behold, I go forward, but he is not there. It says, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. It says, on the left hand where he doth work, but I cannot behold him. It says, he hideth himself on the right hand where it says that I cannot see him. And so we get into a position to where God is working on both sides, and he's working in a way that, sometimes we can't see exactly what he's doing, but we know that he's working. He said that, behold, I go forward, I go backward, I go every direction looking for God, but I cannot find him. I don't see him, but I know that he's working. And it says, but he knoweth the way that I take, and when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. And once God puts us in a position to where he can try us, and he can send us into some things, and when we come out victorious, and he can trust us with some things, we can come out as pure gold. And that gold is a shining effect to where God can show us all. And so well, we understand that Job, when he had lost so much, he lost everything he had, his children, his cattle, everything, even his wife had started to turn on him. But Job didn't turn on God, and Job stayed believing in God, and Job stayed right with God. And through all that he went through, he was believing in God. And he said that after God tried me, I shall come forth as pure gold, and God will change me and turn some things around in my life to where that encounter with God will then cause some things to happen, and God will show me off. But then I want to turn to Jeremiah 1:5, and it says, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Yeah. It says, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. It says, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. And so there's some people that God has already put in position and ordained for some things to happen, but there's some work that has to be done. We have to carry the book bag. And then one of my favorite scriptures that I want to call out is Romans 8:28. And most of you probably know it, but it says, and we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. And it's showing that God has a purpose, and he's had some people that he's going to call into position to where if you understand the story of Ephraim and Manasseh. Manasseh was the older brother, and God had a strategic plan to move it around and switch what we normally see to where the older brother gets the blessing, but God switched it around, and the younger blessing got the brother, because it was some things that had happened, and God understood the plan to where he understood how to get his point across, and he not understand who's going to carry the word. And he already knows things that's going to happen down the line, so he knows when we're a child exactly how to structure things in order to get us in position. And then it says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. I mean, he's already set us up for some things to happen. It says to be conformed to the image of his son. And so he wants us to conform then and have a changed mind and then start to walk into a new image. It said that he might be the firstborn of men among many brethren. And so we understand that there's not a lot of people that tend to go to church now. And in fact, at this point, since people have a reason to stay away, they find more reasons to not come to church than to go to church. But they go everywhere else, as the pastor said. We find them in Walmart, and we find them at work, and we find them walking the streets. But when we say it's time to go to church and it's time to give God some praise, people get a little confused. But to me, it's confusing, because if you understand that we don't have an army, and we don't have a financial background, we don't have a country to be sent to, it's some things that can happen. And we understand that there's a reason that we're on this ground, and God gave a promise to Abraham, and he swore by himself, because he could find nothing greater, that surely blessings I will bless thee and multiply, I will multiply thee, because he multiplied the seed, and he gave a promise that I will keep them, and I will send them into the promised land, and that promise is what's keeping us on the land. So it's confusing when we start to talk about God and what he's done and how great he is, to where people start to figure out, well, I'm doing this and I'm going through that and I'm struggling with this and I'm struggling with that. But God is showing you, every time you get to a struggle, if you just look down and understand that you're standing on holy ground and move over, he's out trying to show you that I've been with you the whole time. Like the three Hebrew boys in the furnace, when they threw him in the furnace and he started looking, the king was trying to figure out exactly why nothing was happening, because they were in the midst of a fire. And we get in the midst of a fire in our life, and we forget that God is with us. And there's a reason why Peter didn't drown on the boat when he found God, and all the water was coming up in the boat, and the boat was starting to crack and break. But he forgot, as long as Jesus is on my boat, I'll be okay. Gucci and Prada on my boat won't help me, but Louis V on my boat won't help me. I said, Ralph Lauren on my boat won't help me.
Jesus on the front with me, I know that everything will be all right.
It says, moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. So you're going to do some things. You're going to do some things that you feel like you shouldn't have done. But God, it doesn't matter about your past. If we understand the woman at the well, she had her past was treacherous. She had done everything against the will. She wasn't a follower, wasn't a believer. She was against them. She had no doings. They could rightfully cut off those people because they had rightfully dissembled themselves from the people of God. And Jesus still went down and waited for this lady of Sychar, this woman of a terrible history, to come through so that he could have a one-on-one encounter and still bring her to a revelation of who he is. So it doesn't matter who you are. We understand that if God turned around someone that was killing Christians and started him to lead the most Christians, we will understand that God can produce the blessing. And he's already set us up in that we have to be justified because we're going to do some things that may cause us to have probably could have been cut off. But God's grace and God's, he's gracious and he loves us in a way that's unconditional no matter what. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. But it takes who he justified, then he also glorified. So after he takes you through some things and you come into a revelation of him, he'll start to show you some new things and it'll start to set you off. And you can see that shining gold as Job was talking about it then. I want to move over to 2 Corinthians 12 and 7, and I'll start right there, and at least I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. It says, there was given to me a thorn in my flesh, just the messenger of Satan to buffet me. And so some of you don't understand this. There's something in your flesh that you're fighting with and you can't get rid of. And God's not going to move it because God has sent that thing to prune you, to cut off some things, to help you to move in a different light. He didn't send that thing for you to change it. He sent it to change you. And so when we understand that for this thing, it said, I besought the Lord thrice and that it may depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. Yes, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. It says, mostly gladly, therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. It says, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distress for Christ's sake. So when I am weak, then I am strong. And then, there's two more for you. Ephesians 2 and 1. And it says, and you have he quickened who were dead in trespasses and in sin. So we understand that if God was to charge us for the life that we've lived, if it was up to our past, us being totaled out for how we live and how we do things and what we do, we would be dead. But because of God and because of his grace and because he saved us by grace, ye who were dead are now alive, and you who were enslaved are now enthroned. It says we were objects of wrath, but now we are objects of grace. It says we walked among the disobedient, but now we fellowship with Christ. It says we were under Satan's dominion, but now we are in a union with Christ. And if we can understand that we were saved by grace and that we who should be dead, that God had grace on us and it quickened us, that we have a reason to come into the house of God and give God some praise the way we should, because there's some things that has happened for us that maybe shouldn't have happened, but we have to understand that we have to suffer a while. And I want to read 1 Peter 5 and 5, and it says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. It says, yea, all of you be subject to one another. It says, and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Which means you don't always have to walk around running your mouth telling everybody everything and talking about everything, because God gives grace to the humble. But I want to give you a secret that the meek shall inherit the earth. And humble is one thing, because being humble means you can be on the up and not say anything. But being meek means I can go through hell and high water and still not say nothing. I can go through everything that I went through and still keep my mouth closed, because I know that all things work together for the good of them that love God and call according to His purpose. And He's telling us some things. But he's trying to get us to understand that just humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time. Yeah. This is after we've carried the bag, after we've spent some time with the Word, after we've got into our Word to where we can start to help somebody else to understand it. He said, in due time, in a certain amount of time, and your time may not be my time, and my time may not be his time, her time may not be his time, but God said that if you have a seed, we have to understand that seeds are so small, but a seed has everything in it from the time that you plant it, from the time that you're born. You have everything in you that calls you to be destined, that calls you to be who God has called you. But sometimes that seed gets the wrong sunlight and water. And when you understand planting, if you plant a seed, that seed has to get the right sunlight and water for it to grow up. But if that seed gets the wrong sunlight and water, it won't grow into what God's called it to be. And some of us are getting the wrong sunlight and water. But if we can get the right sunlight and water and let God prune us and let God be the gardener for us, we can understand that if God sprinkles some everlasting water on our life, that we won't have to worry about anything. So we have to understand that if we're casting our cares, how can we bring somebody else's? If God told you to, if I told you to cast your cares and you bring hers, I'm going to be looking at you like you're crazy. If God told you to come to me, why are you coming to Him with everybody else's? He's waiting for them to come to Him. You can't do it for them. They have to come for themselves and start to read into God's Word and start to tap in, because there's a long, long way of how their relationship with God. You can be all the way from an antichrist to a priest, but it's all about what you're willing to put in. In the story of Isaiah, it was about how deep they were willing to dig in order for God to pour water. And it was all in the room that God had to work with that He was able to fill, because only when we give God to work with. So what she was talking about, being empty, we had to come empty so that we can get filled with the right things and the right spirits, and God can start to fill us with what He wants to be filled and what He wants to be us. And people can see a reflection to where, if we understand that we have our favorite restaurants and we have our favorite places to be, and when we go there, we expect a certain taste, a certain flavor. But that's the same thing when people see God's children and people see God's people. They're expecting a certain type of person. They're expecting a certain flavor, a certain aroma. And when we understand that we have to read the God's Word in order to hear His voice, I try to figure out, how can you hear God's voice if you don't know His words? I spoke a message on that, but it confuses me. If you're not in the Word and you're not reading, you're not understanding what's going on, who are you listening to? What are you hearing? Because for me, God's Word came back to remembrance after I read it, and I got into the middle of that fiery furnace, and I remember that God told me that even though I was in the middle of the furnace before I got in there, He had already made the Word true that I would be okay when I came out. But if I didn't know that He had already made it okay, I wouldn't have been able to get into the furnace and be okay. But be sober, be vigilant. He said, it's because your adversary, the devil, he said, there's a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. And so the devil is searching to devour some of God's people and some of God's children. But we understand that the eyes of the Lord are still searching to and fro, looking upon the earth, that someone who they may throw themselves strong to. And so just as the devil is searching, the eyes of the Lord are searching to see who's like Job, who's willing to lose everything and still say that even though that I'm going through all this, I still trust God no matter what, because I know that He has me in a position for me to get double for my trouble. And said, be vigilant. It said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion, is seeking. It says, but whom resist the steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren, so that are in the world, says, but the grace of, but the God of all grace who have called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, established, make you perfect, established, strengthened, settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever, ever. Amen. And so what we understand is that that with our faith, it's impossible to please God. And Hebrews and 6 is saying that we understand that, but strong meat belongeth to them that are full of age, and even just those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. And it says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine, it's talking about the elementary principles, it's talking about leaving what you're used to. It says, let us go unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. So our works have to be alive, and we have to understand our works and our faith must go together in order to please God. But it says of the doctrine of baptisms and of laying of hands, it says of the resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment, it says, and this we will do if God permit. And so what he's trying to get them to understand is that let's stop being babies in the world, let's stop being children in the world, and let's go through what God has set for us to go through, and let's carry our book bag as Joseph did, and let's understand that God is setting us up for a much greater purpose. And most times he's setting us up for something that we're not able to see, because God had Joseph on a strategic plan his whole entire life. And Joseph, who he is so important, because he's born to Jacob and Rachel, and we understand what Jacob had to go through in order to get Rachel's hand. And he was a love child, and Joseph was of the two love children that they had between him and Benjamin. And we understand that this story is strategic, because God is trying to show us that if we carry the book bag until God brings the briefcase, we'll be prosperous. There are some things in the book bag that has to come on us for us to be able to do away with the book bag, so that then we can carry the briefcase and still be able to do God's will. If we can understand going to school and understanding that we all want to be a 10, but we don't want to be a 1 again. And if you understand school and you understand learning, we want to be a 10 in a small arena, but in order to grow bigger, you have to be a 1 on the next level and start over again. If you're a 10, in order to be a 20, you have to be an 11 and start over again. If you want to be a 30, you have to be a 21 and start over again. If you want to be a 40, you have to be a 31 and start over again. So as levels go up, we have to understand that just because you may be big in one arena, when God brings you into a different arena, he wants to start you off from scratch and start to build you up on a strong foundation, because the storm is coming. We understand that the Bible tells us that regardless if you build on a strong foundation or not, that storm is coming, and that if you haven't built your house on a strong foundation, that your house will surely blow over, and you won't be able to withstand the storm. But Joseph was able to withstand the storm, and Joseph being born as a love child and being born to Joseph and understanding that he had to go through a treacherous process to where he was the child that had the coat of the many colors, and he was reverenced by God with the coat. And sometimes, as he teaches us to understand that when we have children, that we give the ones that we love the most the best things. Not that we don't love the other ones, but God has a strategic plan, because he knows which children need what in order to succeed. Some children don't need the same love as others. Some needs to be pushed away for a while. And we understand Jacob thought he was dead, because his brothers had took him off, and his brothers, that they had a problem with Joseph, because they didn't like Joseph, because he was a dreamer. And most times, as a child and as a children, when we're kids, and you're a dreamer, the ones that aren't dreamers, the ones that have problems that don't know how to solve them, they shoot you down and they try to hold you down from dreaming and becoming who God has called you to be. But God has a specific plan, even in those who thought they were changing your life and thought that they were doing some things to cause you to go off track. God was saying that was the track that I had you on. And what we understand about Joseph is Joseph was thrown into a pit by his brothers, and the thing is, he Well, in life, it's always the ones that's closest to us. It's our family that does us dirty the most. And if that's what the Bible is teaching us, that these were his brothers. And you would expect that if I'm going off for a walk with my brothers, I should be okay. I should be a secure more with them than anybody else. But we found out that Joseph ended up in a pit because of his brothers. And he ended up going through a many of series of different things. He ended up being sold and going into slavery and being bought by the Midianites for 20 pieces of silver. And he had to go through many of different things to where he had to go into Potiphar's house and take over Potiphar's house. And he became the overseer, and God showed us that even when Joseph was going through these things, that God was showing him that even as he told Moses and told Joshua that God was still with him, and God was still there showing himself true. And even when Joseph was lied on by the wife, and he had to go to prison, and he was in prison because he had been lied on, because he wouldn't sleep with her. And in the prison, God still showed himself true, because God sent a problem that only Joseph could solve. And sometimes we get into a position to where we don't understand that God has us in this position and God has us in this place because we're frustrated because there's an issue. And we're trying to figure out exactly what to do, but God gives us all a specific way of understanding something, in a different way that someone else doesn't, so that you can have your blessing. I used to try to figure out why people didn't understand the things in the way that I understood them. Why didn't people do the things the way that I did them? Why didn't people move or go in the route that I went? But what God showed me was that everybody isn't in search of the same thing. Everybody isn't actually going in the direction of the same thing. But what you understand is that some people aren't after a life everlasting. They're not after a life of God and a life of fulfilling the blessing, because they're so destruction and distraught from what the world has brought that they can't see clearly and understand exactly what's going on. But God has a specific plan even in the destruction, even in not being able to see. Sometimes God helps us not to be able to see, just to see if we're going to stay on track, if we're going to stay in that position, or are we going to go astray? Are we going to stop trusting and believing because we can't see him? Because that most days we aren't there, but we get mad at God when he isn't there. But the thing is, we have to still trust and believe, even though we can't see and know exactly what God is doing. We have to be able to have faith. As he told the disciples when he sent them to wait to be endued with power, we have to understand when God sends us to move, there's a reason, and there's something that he's causing us to meet us, but we have to understand to move and be on task. And if we're not on task, if we're not on time, we may miss the blessing. If Moses didn't meet to the Red Sea when he did with the rod, potentially they could have gotten caught. But we know that God put an angel behind them, so that wasn't the case. But still, timing is important, and how God moves is important. And in this story of Joseph, God's timing is perfect, and he's called Joseph to come into a place to where only he can solve this problem. And they're having these dreams, and they're seeing things, and they're dreaming, and they need someone to tell them and help them to explain what did they see and interpret the dream. And Joseph is the one who God sent with this power to be able to do this. And this has called Joseph to move from the pit and being sold off by his brothers all the way to the house of Pharaoh. And he's been set as governor over the house of Pharaoh and ruler. And God has granted him favor in the middle of a famine. And if we understand that sometimes our life, we get into a famine and we don't understand God's favor. And it's funny, because I've been telling people through COVID, I've made more money in COVID than I made before. Amen. And so in the middle of this favor, in the middle of this famine, God has granted favor. But sometimes we get so caught up in what we're going through, we don't even understand and see what God is doing. And in this story, as Joseph is being granted favor, he's moving from the pit to the palace, and he's been a given ruler over Egypt, and he's the one that Egypt now comes to for corn, because the ruler has understood that God is with him and God has given him favor. And so at this point, Joseph has been through so much, and he's understood that he's went through all of these different things to be able to come back and then teach his people and save his people. So sometimes we're going through things, and therefore other people. Sometimes we're going through different things so that God can teach us some things, so that when we have some people that come to us and we have some people that come and they need some advice, God can birth a new nation because you can show somebody a new way. But the thing is, everybody don't cope the same way. I may not be able to show you, but she may be able to. And so we all have our own nation to birth, but we have to come into a revelation so that God can use us. So we all have people that's following and looking after us and seeing what it is that we should be doing. And if we're doing what we're supposed to do, and we're carrying our book bag to where our word is in us, and we're able to show them and enlighten them and to cause them to have a revelation and experience with God in a new way, we can birth some people in ways that we've never seen before. And so we understand that in this situation, Joseph is being granted favor, but there's a famine in the land, and while he's in favor, while he's being rode around on chariots and being taken care of hand and foot and being the governor, his family is in the middle of a famine. And his father, Jacob, he's there and he's trying to figure out exactly what to do because the family will die if they don't get food. And they're in the middle of this famine to where food is running short and they're running out of their resources. And they don't know what to do, but God has a very strategic plan because he's trying to get them to understand how to move through trouble. And God is showing them that I have set some things up, but they can't see them yet. And so at this point, Jacob sends his sons down into Egypt, and he sends them into Egypt to get corn. And they're there to get corn, but they don't understand who they're talking to. And this teaches us that sometimes we have to watch how we treat people, because just because Joseph was thrown into the pit, and he wasn't much at one position, at one point in the story, Joseph was now the king. And so when we treat people in one light and we don't treat them right, when we come back to them and we have to now ask for some things because this famine has now humbled us to a point to where we have to now get on our knees and ask, because his brothers, when they came, they were on their knees asking him and trying to get food, but they still didn't know exactly who they were talking to. But he sent them through a series of things, and it even shows him crying out and going into a wept between Egypt, because even though you may have all these different things and you may be the ruler over Egypt and you may have corn and you may have all this, your family is still important. And without family, nothing matters. And you can get to a point to where you have a plethora of everything, but still, he still wanted to know, is my father still alive? And he understood, when he was trying to figure out exactly what to do, he went through a strategic planning of keeping Benjamin, and he put his cup into Benjamin's sack, and they started to search for the cup to where they found it in his sack. But he sent them through many of different things to what have caused you to understand that he knew a little bit more than they thought he knew. And if you can understand his conversation and what he was asking and what he was telling them, how he was moving, it would give you a light to understand that this must be somebody that knows me. And so God has set up a position to where even when they came to buy the corn, when he sent them back with the money that they came to spend, even in their sacks. And so he didn't take their money. And so they're so confused trying to figure out that did he leave the money in there because they're going to keep my brother, or did I do something wrong? They're so nervous trying to figure out exactly what has happened, because we understand who they are and how they think. Their thought process is often, when your thought process is not clean and it's not right and your spirit is off, sometimes you trouble yourself because you're rattled in how you're thinking, what you're doing, and you know that it's off. When something like that happens, when God comes to bless you, that blessing turns into a curse because of how you think.
Yeah. All right.
And so if we understand that he had blessed them and he was showing them favor to where they didn't end up paying for this, and they came back, they were confused, but when when Joseph revealed himself, they were shocked and they were confused trying to figure out exactly what was happening, because the last time they saw him, he was in a pit and they had sold him off, but they were confused, and he told them that don't worry about it, don't be upset, because God had positioned and put this all together so that when my family needed me, and when everything went dry, and when the famine hit the land of Canaan, he was able to come and he was able to save his people. So we understand that God has a specific plan and a specific position that he had you in. And sometimes as a parent, you think your child is dead, but God is working, and sometimes
as a child, you're going through things and you're trying to figure out, where is everybody at? I feel like I'm by myself. I feel like I don't have any help. But God is positioning you to carry the book bag, because when he brings the briefcase and when he brings the favor, well, even though there's famine on the land, no matter where Joseph was, God granted him favor, and everything that he touched was blessed to prosper. It says, but in the story, Jacob was troubled, and Jacob, he didn't want to send Benjamin because he had told him that you come and you want to take Benjamin with you, but I have lost Joseph, the only other love child, and now you want to take Benjamin instead of chance that he might not come back, and he didn't want to do it, but God understood how to make Jacob move, and how he knew what would make Jacob move, but God didn't send Jacob through that, because sometimes God just wants to see if we're ready to go. If we're willing to go through some things, and because we're willing to go through some things, God will then go through some things for us. As we see, Jesus gave his life for the church, and we understand how giving your life and the love and the unconditional love, that was the love that the man was taught to teach, to show the wife, and the wife was taught to submit. But that's another story. But we understand that in Jacob, he had to go through some things. And he came to a point to where he told them, he said that with all these things and with all this stress, he said, I've come to a point to where if one more thing happens, if something else goes wrong, he said, I I'm to my gray hairs and I'm going to go to my grave because I can't take it. And sometimes God has us in a position to where right when we're ready to break down and right when we're ready to give up, God is showing us that I put a plan in position to where there's some chariots coming to get you and take you to the land that I've set for you so that you can eat and be taken care of for the rest of your life. Yeah. And so what God does is, as he's pruning Joseph and getting Joseph ready, he's also getting the family ready. But he has to get the family ready in the midst of a famine, and in the midst of this famine when they're losing things, he's showing them how to move through trouble, because God helped them to move through this famine, and they came into a land to where they were taken care of. And we understand these are Hebrew people eating Egyptian bread, and Joseph is a Hebrew boy, and he's in the house of Egypt, and he's the ruler over the house of Egypt. He has control over everything, controlling the corn, and they now have to go to a Hebrew boy in the house of Egypt in order to get what they need, because we understand when God shows favor, it doesn't matter, because Joseph had carried the book bag, and Joseph had went in the book bag and had all the resources, and Joseph had carried it to a point to where his Bible was now on him, and he knew exactly how to move when God called, and God brought the briefcase, and he brought the favor, and now Joseph was walking in the favor, and everything that he touched, and everything that he did was blessed to prosper, and he was able to then go through all these different things and tell his brothers that don't worry about what you put me through, don't worry about what you did to me, because God was positioning me to come back and take care of the family. Everybody from my father all the way down, and we understand that this story is specific because Joseph and Jacob didn't know whether or not they would see each other again, but God was so strategic that he helped him. He said that not only will you get to see Joseph again, but you'll get to see his seeds, and Jacob was able to bless Manasseh and Ephraim, and he was able to then put them back into position, because God understood that if this didn't happen, that it may be thrown off. But God's plan is specific, and what God did when Jacob was getting ready to die, he said his eyes were dim because of old age, and it shows that Jacob couldn't see, but it was his hands, and he was moving his hands, and even Joseph went to remove the hand because he didn't want Ephraim to get the blessing first. But Jacob told him, no, my son, I know. He said, I understand that you want Manasseh to be blessed. But he said, no, Ephraim means to be fertile, to be fruitful. And Manasseh means to be forgetful. And he said, I want you to understand that as long as you're fruitful and you're fertile, that is some things to be changed around for you to get the blessing. And as long as you carry the book bag and you understand how things go, the same God that moved the blind man with the specific story and set him up for humiliation in front of the disciples. And they were trying to figure out, who do we blame? Because sometimes in our life, we get to a position where we're trying to figure out, who do we blame? But see, God says, blame me, because I put you in a position to where after you were blind, he didn't spit and picked up the mud, and he ran him again in front of the people and told him to go wash in the pool. And we understand that. How can you get to the pool if you're blind? But when after God does what he does, we're able to move in a way that people don't know how it happened. People don't know what happened. But even if we understand Job had double for his trouble, we understand David and who he was. David, one still to a king. And David, no matter whether it was playing music or fighting giants, David was willing. And we understand how Joshua was a tenacious fighter. And Joshua stood on holy ground, but God had to tell him to move over, because you have to understand that that ground you're standing on is holy. And then we have to understand that sometimes we are the person that we're asking God to send, but we have to carry the bag. We have to get ready. We have to go through the process. We have some things that we have to be cut away from. God has to prune us in a way so that we can be a light. God has to show us some things in a new way so that we can walk in a new light and start to teach people to talk to people in a different way, because it was all about what Joseph was willing to go through. Joseph was willing to go through whatever he had to go through in order to get to his blessing. And it was the famine that created his favor. And sometimes we're in the middle of a famine and we get so caught up and frustrated that we're arguing and we're fighting with God, but we don't understand that God has put us in a position so that he can teach us some things so that we can fight like David. David went through all those different fights, and none of the fights before the last one were as big as that one, because all those fights was just teaching him to understand that when God tells me to fight, it's time to move. But today's message, and understanding Joseph and understanding how we have to carry the bag, how we have to go through some things, how we have to be thrown into a pit, how we have to go being sold off strategically and carry our own cross. Because God, as Jesus said, that whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. So I want to help somebody this morning to carry the cross and to carry the bag. So when you understand that they'll see that you're going through and they'll see that God has you in, you may not like it, you may not want to do it, but it's in the mix of that specific thing that God's going to bring you through. And he's going to bring you into a new life, because it's a fiery furnace that burns everything off, that we can come out with a new revelation of who God is. So today I come to let you know to carry the book bag until God brings the briefcase. Because if you carry the book bag, and we're standing with our word, and we're reading the word, and we're growing in the word, and we're letting God prune us and bring us into a position.